We have been looking at methods for solving nonlinear algebraic equations, and in that till now we have covered gradient free methods or successive substitutions, then gradient based methods, and now I want to move on to a third category, which is optimization based methods. So if I just draw or if I just collate what are the different methods that we have seen, so for solving nonlinear algebraic equations, the first method that we saw was successive substitution. So here we had different variants like Jacobi iterations, Gauss-Seidel iterations, and so on. Then the second class, I would say, is gradient or slope, gradient or slope based methods. And here we had we have looked at univariate secant method, multivariate secant, or which is popularly known as Bechstein, popularly known as Bechstein iterations. So we looked at univariate secant method, which was slope based method. I would, instead of saying gradient based method, I would say slope based method. It will use two consecutive iterates and then find a slope and use that slope to find out the next step. Then we looked at multivariate secant method. Under the same category, we moved to Newton-Raphson or Newton's method, sometimes known as Newton-Raphson method. So here we had some modification. So damped Newton's method, then we looked at quasi-Newton method. Damped Newton method was adjusting the step length. Quasi-Newton method was Jacobian matrix update using rank 1 matrices or Broyden's update. So this was using Broyden update. Well, of course, you can combine these two and have a Newton's method, which is damped Newton method with, or quasi Newton, damped Newton, the damped method, and so on. So you can have all the combinations. So these are the categories in which we have looked at solving nonlinear algebraic equations. The third category that I want to look at is optimization based. Okay, so first two categories we have looked at in detail. The third one, the optimization based, it has its parallel in solving linear algebraic equations. Linear algebraic equations we solved using gradient method, conjugate gradient method. Likewise, here too, we can form solving nonlinear algebraic equations as an optimization problem and iteratively solve the optimization problem till you reach the solution. Okay, so what are these optimization based methods? So here we form an optimization problem. See, I want to solve for f of x equal to 0, x belongs to Rn, x is an n dimensional vector, and f of x equal to 0 is what I want to solve for. I formulate an objective function phi of x. I formulate an objective function phi of x, which is half fx transpose fx, which is nothing but half f1x square plus. So I have this function vector f, which has components F1 to FN. So we want to minimize this, okay? We want to minimize this with respect to X. So we solve the problem. We solve the problem as minimize with respect to X phi of X. Okay? What is the optimum? How do you reach the, what is the necessary condition for optimality? The gradient is equal to 0. So dou phi by dou X, that is dou F by dou X transpose F of X is equal to 0. This is the optimality criteria. Okay, and you can see that when the Jacobian is non-singular at the optimum, only way you can get the necessary condition satisfied is when f of x is equal to 0. If this is Jacobian is non-singular, then only way you can get the solution or to this problem of, you know, the necessary condition being satisfied when f of x is equal to 0. So this is when you reach the optimum, and when you reach a stationary point where the Jacobian is non-singular, then you have reached the optimum. Then you reach the solution of f of x equal to 0. That is the idea. Now how do you solve this? How do you, well, we do it iteratively using different numerical optimization methods. The first one, of course, the simplest one to use would be gradient method. But as I told you, the gradient method has a problem. So simplest would be gradient method. And this is, as I said, gradient method is more useful for deriving more complex method. It forms the basis. Probably we would not use gradient method. We use conjugate gradient method. But just to state the algorithm, gradient method would start with an initial guess x naught, and then you will get xk plus 1 is equal to xk plus lambda k gk, and gk is minus grad phi x, that is evaluated at x is equal to xk, which is nothing but, well, if we develop a notation, I'll just do it here. So if I develop a notation jk, which is dou f by dou x evaluated at x is equal to xk, if I do this notation, and then of course f at xk is equal to f superscript k. If I use this notation, we have used this notation earlier, the same notation I'm using, okay, then this would be minus jk transpose fk. Gk would be, how do you compute lambda k? This is a scalar parameter, step length parameter, and this is found by one dimensional minimization. Okay, this is found by one dimensional minimization. So this is a iterative numerical procedure by which you start from x naught, you generate a new guess in the direction of negative of the gradient direction, and at each time how much to move is decided by minimizing with respect to lambda. Okay, so lambda k is min with respect to lambda phi xk plus lambda gk. Okay, so lambda k is just one dimensional minimization, gk is the gradient direction which you have computed, okay, xk is known to you, GK is known to you, lambda is not known, which is found by this. So, of course, more popular method or more better way, more computationally efficient way is to use conjugate gradients. Okay. So, in fact, in MATLAB, when you are solving nonlinear algebraic equations, simultaneous nonlinear algebraic equations, there is a subroutine called fsol. I think fsol is not Newton-Raphson, it is optimization based solver. It actually forms an optimization problem and minimizes by iterative search. Okay. Let me confirm, but I think it's fsolve is not a Newton-Raphson solver, it's a optimization based solver. So the reason is that even though we have written here in terms of the gradient direction is written in terms of Jacobian and multiplied by fk, actually if you numerically compute gradient of phi k, if you are numerically computing gradient of phi k, phi x k, this numerical gradient computation doesn't involve explicitly computing Jacobian. See, this is a function, phi k is half f1 x square to right. So if I want to compute, this is phi x, if I want to compute the numerical Jacobian of this, okay, I need to compute function vector and take its norm. Okay, I don't have to explicitly compute Jacobian. Okay, computing the numerical or computing gradient of this is equivalent to, you understand what I'm saying? See, computing grad phi x is equivalent to, you know, dou f by dou x transpose fx. These two are equivalent. But numerical computation of this, if you perturb this function vector, see, what I have to do for, how do you compute numerical Jacobian or numerical gradient? We have a subroutine which we have written, right, in the programming tutorial. We perturb each element, we perturb each element and by plus epsilon, minus epsilon, and then find out. So see, basically what I do is to compute, if I want to compute dou phi by dou xi, okay, what we do is we approximate this as phi xi plus epsilon minus phi xi minus epsilon. I am just perturbing the ith element, remaining elements are same, okay, divided by 2 epsilon, right. This is how we find out, and of course here I have not written remaining elements of x. This phi is a function of remaining elements of x, just to show you that. So doing this, you know, function calculation doesn't involve anywhere explicitly computing Jacobian. You see the advantage? It only that this is equivalent to this. This is equivalent to this. Okay. So actually numerically when you are computing, you don't have to go through this route. You don't have to compute Jacobian. Okay. So there are advantages in using optimization based search, because you don't have to compute Jacobian explicitly. For a large scale problem, okay, you are not required to compute 1000 cross 1000 matrix. That's not required. Okay, is this clear? Okay. So now, what about conjugate gradient? Okay, so of course we compute the conjugate gradient, of course requires the current gradient information. So we need this gk, which is negative of grad x. Gradient of phi with respect to x. This is the direction. So this we have to compute at x equal to xk. And what we do next, of course, is find the conjugate search direction. Now, what was the idea in generating conjugate directions? The idea in conjugate direction was, given some matrix A, we said that two search directions are A conjugate, okay, when S K transpose S K minus 1 is equal to 0. Given the A matrix, which is positive definite matrix, okay, we call search direction SK and SK minus 1 as A conjugate. Okay, when you take any two successive directions, you should have this property. Okay, so what is done in the conjugate gradient method here is you find out the search directions such that A is equal to I. Okay, so we find out the search direction such that the alternate directions are perpendicular to each other. Okay, alternate directions are perpendicular to each other. So we find out SK, this is equal to beta k times SK minus 1 plus GK. GK is the gradient which we have calculated currently, and beta k is given by minus GK transpose. Okay, and the remaining part is similar to the gradient method. That is, once you know the search direction, then you find out xk plus 1 is equal to xk plus lambda sk. Okay, find out lambda k, which is minimization with respect to lambda phi . Do this one dimensional minimization. Okay, so just to find out the step length, see, this beta k which is computed here, this is only for finding out the new search direction, which is conjugate with respect to identity matrix. Okay, so this is direction computation. Once you compute the direction sk, how much to move in that direction? See, one interpretation of this conjugate directions is that it is linear combination of previous gradients, because you kick off this calculation using, so you at zero you set, that is g, so your s0 corresponds to g0. The first direction is same as the gradient direction. Next time, okay, S1 is beta 1 G0 plus G1. Okay, so linear combination of G0 and G1. When you go to G2, it will be linear combination of G0, G1, G2, because S1 is linear combination of G0, G1. Okay, so S2 turns out to be linear combination of G0, G1, G2. So it's like saying, instead of using current, so once I get this direction here, okay, then I know that I want to move in this direction. This direction is linear combination of past all gradients. See, it's like just imagine, you know, you are going down a valley. Okay, now what do you mean by using gradient step? You are looking at the current slope. Okay, you are looking at the current slope. Now, just looking at the current slope could be, you know, too local. You don't have information about what has happened in the past. If you take into consideration somehow, okay, if you make your next move based on the, you know, information about the past slopes, okay, then your move will be much better than just basing your decision on the current slope. Because if you take into consideration past slopes, okay, in some way you are taking into consideration the curvature, right? You are taking into consideration the curvature along the path and then making your decision. See here, if you look at how this conjugate gradient method proceeds, so the step here would be, you know, xk plus 1 will be xk plus lambda k sk. So if I actually look at the progression of how the direction changes, see, this will be s0 is equal to g0, the first time whatever the gradient that you get, negative of the gradient direction. Okay, what is next time? S1 is equal to beta1 s0 plus negative of the gradient direction at a new point. Okay, what is S2? Beta2 S1 plus G2, which is same as beta2 You see this? So as you progress, okay, you are actually basing your move direction based on not just one gradient, but a history of gradients. Okay, that's why conjugate gradient direction, you know, turns out to be more powerful. It moves much faster even when you go close to the optimum as compared to the. What is the problem with the gradient method? When you go close to the optimum, it tends to become slow. Okay, whereas here the move is based on past history of gradients. Okay, so it's like when you are going down a hill, you are trying to make use of the curvature rather than trying to make use of the local slope. The gradient method will just look at the local slopes. Okay, gradient method will only look at negative of gradient or g0, g1, g2, g3, g4. Okay, so that is why conjugate gradient method is more powerful. Now there is one more variant. Here in the gradient method, you are only using the local gradient information, right? You are only using local gradient information. Now if you can generate something more, okay, if you can generate Hessian, what is Hessian? The second derivative of the objective function. If you generate Hessian, okay, then your moves are much better because you are using more information about the local curvature than just the gradient. Okay, Hessian computation would require second derivatives to be calculated, and then, you know, the methods, optimization methods that you get which use Hessian to generate the search direction, these are called as Newton's optimization method. Okay, so we'll just briefly look at this Newton's method. Now don't confuse the Newton-Raphson method and the Newton's method here. This is optimization based method, that is that is a successive substitution kind of method. So these are names appear similar, but so under the category of optimization we have again Newton's method and quasi-Newton method. Okay, so the Newton and quasi-Newton methods. So now, okay, so what did we start with? We started by saying that to solve f of x equal to 0, we form this objective function phi, which is half f x transpose f x, right? Half f x transpose f x. And what is the What is the necessary condition for optimality? Necessary condition for optimality is grad x phi is equal to 0, right? This should be equal to 0 vector. The gradient at the stationary point, the gradient of this objective function should be equal to 0, 0 vector. Okay. This is a nonlinear algebraic equation. Okay. This is a nonlinear algebraic equation. Now this nonlinear algebraic, because what is phi is a scalar function. See, phi is nothing but half norm fx, 2 norm square. This is nothing but 2 norm square. Norm is a scalar. Okay, objective function is a scalar objective function. This is a scalar objective function. So this, what is this grad phi? Is it a vector or a matrix? It's a vector. It's not a matrix. This is equal to dou phi by dou x1, dou phi by dou x2, dou phi by dou xn transpose. This is equal to 0 vector. So this is actually a, because phi is a scalar, its gradient with respect to x, okay, is a vector. This vector I want to set equal to 0. Okay. If I solve this equation exactly, okay, then I will get the solution. Okay. But my problem is nonlinear, I cannot solve this exactly. Okay. What I decide to do is, instead of solving this equation exactly, I decide to solve this using Newton's step. So to use Newton's step, what I'm going to do is I'm going to linearize this equation. Okay, I'm going to linearize this equation. Exactly compute? How will I get f of x equal to 0? No. If analytically this grad x phi is dou f by dou x transpose f of x. Okay, so if Jacobian matrix is non-singular, then this equal to 0 means this will happen only if f of x equal to 0. Okay. So when you set this equal to 0, if this is non-zero, only way you will get, or this is non-singular, only way you will get 0 here is when f of x is equal to 0. This vector is equal to 0. That's how you get the solution.
It's the same.
It's the same. It's getting the solution is same. Okay. So now I want to come up with a Newton step here. So what I'm going to do here is something like this. I'll continue here on this side. Okay, so what I need to do here is this, my grad phi x. Okay, I'm going to write this as grad phi xk plus okay, and use our good old Taylor series expansion. Okay, so this is approximately equal to grad phi xk, okay, plus del square phi. In fact, you will realize why this is called Newton's method, because this is exactly what you do in Newton. What you do in Newton's method for solving algebraic equation, you have nonlinear algebraic equations, you linearize, and then instead of solving the original problem, you solve the linearized problem, right? So this we call as HK. HK is the Hessian, okay? HK is the Hessian, and this is the gradient, and which we have shown that this is nothing but JK transpose FK, we have, I have shown this earlier. This is JK transpose FK. And now, instead of solving for grad phi x equal to 0, I am going to solve for this approximation equal to 0 vector. Okay. HK is a square matrix. So this is a n cross n matrix. Phi is a scalar objective function. Its second derivative with respect to x is the Hessian matrix. We have looked at Hessian matrix earlier when we talked about the conditions for optimality, necessary and sufficient conditions for optimality. This is the Hessian matrix. Okay. This is the Jacobian transpose FK. Well, again, I have written here Jacobian transpose FK, but you don't have to explicitly compute Jacobian. It's more for getting insights. Okay. So now I'm going to solve for this. Okay. If I solve for this, I get delta XK is equal to minus HK inverse. I am just solving for that approximate Taylor series expansion. Okay. And what I get here is the step, Newton like step. Okay. So this is my search direction. Okay. So the way I construct my next xk plus 1 is xk plus, then what you do is the same thing, you know, you take lambda times delta xk, okay, and then you do a search with respect to lambda. Okay, so that part remains same. So lambda k is equal to min with respect to lambda phi of xk plus lambda okay. So this part remains same, one dimensional minimization, but then the step or the direction for moving is obtained using the second order derivative. Okay. So actually, if you look at optimization method, optimization based method, let's say just the raw gradient method, then conjugate gradient method, and then Newton's method. Of course, Newton's method is faster in converging. That is because you are using second order derivative information. Okay, you are using second order derivative information. So this is more powerful method. But the price to pay is computing Hessian. Hessian is the n cross n matrix. If your number of equations is, or number of variables is large, Hessian matrix is large, and again the same problem. So, you know, fast computations or less number of steps, but large number of computations at each time step, or large number of iterations and less computations at each time step. So it, or not each time step, iteration. Okay. So it's a balance. In some cases, you know, it's worth computing the Hessian and doing quick steps. In some cases, Hessian computation can be complex, and so you might want to use just the conjugate gradient method and search for the optimum. Okay. So okay, now of course the direction, the gradient direction, or this direction which you get should be a descent direction, and that requires that Hessian should be positive definite and so on. So the convergence condition will depend upon the nature of H or the local Hessian. Okay, so what is the trouble with, what is the advantage of Hessian? You are using second order information. Okay, convergence can be much better. Okay, what is the trouble? You have to compute a n cross n matrix. Okay, in Newton's method, how did we get over this problem? We got over this problem in Newton's method using Broyden update, right? We use rank one updates, and then, you know, we had a way of updating Jacobian. Okay, just like a difference equation, and then we use the updated value of the Jacobian rather than actually computing the Jacobian. So the same thing is done here. The quasi Newton methods, okay, actually use a rank one update of the Hessian inverse. What you need to compute here is the inverse of the Hessian matrix. Okay, so what is done is, in quasi Newton methods, let's define this matrix L to be H inverse. See, trouble step in doing this? The trouble step in doing this. See, this is the gradient calculation. This is the gradient. Gradient calculation is just one vector calculation by numerical perturbation, not a big issue. But calculating Hessian, see, gradient you can do relatively easily because there are only n components in the gradient of scalar function phi. Okay, much less computations than computing the Hessian. Okay, Hessian would require a lot more computations. Okay. Now, to avoid Hessian computations, we do gradient computation by numerical perturbation, but Hessian we do an update. Okay. So let's define this L is equal to H inverse. Then we have this update. This is called as variable metric or Davidson-Fechter-Powell method, in which you update the inverse of Hessian iteratively. So only once in the beginning you compute the inverse, and after that you just update it without actually having to compute it explicitly. Okay, so this is a quasi-Newton idea where you don't have to explicitly keep computing the Hessian. So here you have this update L k plus. So we compute, you compute L 0 is equal to H 0 inverse. You compute this once in the beginning. Okay, and after that what we do is we have this L k plus 1 is equal to L k plus mk minus nk. Okay, in quasi-Newton method this is the philosophy, that is you define a matrix L is equal to H inverse. Okay, you only once compute this, and then every time what you do is the new inverse is old inverse plus some correction. Okay, this correction does not involve explicit Hessian computation. What is this correction? Okay, let's move to now the derivation of this is you can find in any book on optimization. So derivation of this particular approach, I am going to just leave it to your curiosity. You can go back to a book by S.S. Rao or any other book on optimization and you will find a derivation. Okay, so you define a vector qk. I am just giving you the final formula, which is phi evaluated at k plus 1 minus grad phi evaluated at iteration k. Okay, mk, the correction 1 is lambda k delta xk transpose qk. So this is a rank 1 matrix. Delta xk is the previous move. Okay, and this is a rank 1 matrix. Delta xk transpose will be a rank 1 matrix. Okay, and nk, okay, mk and nk are two corrections which are rank 1 corrections. Yeah, no, this is after. See, the sequence is like this, that the sequence is that you already have computed delta xk. Okay, you already have computed delta xk. Okay, you have then minimized and found out lambda k. Okay, then you have found out xk plus 1. Okay, once you have found out xk plus 1, now for the next iteration you are preparing. Okay, so once I have found out xk plus 1, I actually go back here and find this new gradient at k plus 1. Take the difference between the new gradient and the old gradient. Okay, and use that and delta xk and previous inverse. Okay, previous inverse. Okay, difference between the old gradient and the new gradient and delta xk mu and the lambda k which you have found out. All of them are used to come up with a approximate, you know, inverse of the Hessian at the next time step. Okay, so that is how this quasi-Newton methods proceed. Well, we don't have, this is not a full course on optimization. I'm just trying to give you the idea that nonlinear algebraic equations can be very efficiently solved using optimization based methods. Okay, so we are just, as I said, or I keep saying throughout this course, we are just touching the tip of the iceberg. We are not really getting into the deep. Okay. Well, the last thing which I want to talk here is a method which is very, very popular in solving nonlinear algebraic equation. This is called as Liverberg and Marquardt method. Liverberg and Marquardt method is a combination of gradient method and Hessian method. Okay, see, what is the nice thing about the gradient method? Gradient method, when you are far away from the optimum, it makes very long strides. It tries to move towards the optimum very quickly. Okay, but once it comes close to the optimum, you know, there is a problem. It becomes very, very slow. The optimization, the Hessian based method, on the other hand, is very fast when you come close to the optimum. Okay, so there is a merit in having a method which is mixture of the two, which initially starts like a gradient method and later on becomes like a Hessian method. Okay, so this or in the modern parlance, it's like a multiple agent optimization method. There are two agents. One is the gradient method, other is the Hessian method. And then you try to mix them in such a way that one is dominant when it is useful, the other is dominant when that becomes useful. Okay. So this is just a small modification. I'm just going to give the philosophy. I'm not going to get into details. So what you do here is that, you know, you have this gradient direction, which is minus I have this gradient direction. Okay. What I do is my search direction SK is found by minus of this is, if I put this theta k equal to 0, it is nothing but the Newton step. If you go back and check, this will be nothing but a Newton step. Okay, the Newton step actually does involve negative of the gradient direction. It does involve, except it is pre-multiplied by H inverse. Okay, it is pre-multiplied by H inverse. Otherwise, it involves negative of the gradient direction. So what we do is, okay, we start with this neta to be very large. Okay, so you start with large value of neta, say 10 to the power 5 or something. You take a large value of neta. So actually your H0 plus 10 to the power 5 times I. Okay. See, Hessian elements will not be typically very large. Okay. So you have to take this number sufficiently large compared to elements of the Hessian. Okay, so this inverse, when this is a large number, is approximately like 10 to the power 5 I inverse. This term dominates over this. Okay, so initially you start with very large neta. Okay, so neta 0 is chosen to be 10 to the power 5. And then what you do is you go on reducing neta. Okay, as k increases. So initially since this is like I inverse, this direction, SK direction, is along the negative of the gradient direction. So initially you are moving along the negative of the gradient direction. Okay, and then you go on. Okay. So we reduce neta k as k increases by some logic. Okay, as neta k reduces, this terms become smaller and smaller, and this starts dominating. The Hessian starts dominating. Okay, so initially the method behaves like gradient method. Later on, the method behaves like the Hessian based method. So Liverberg-Marquardt method. I think you have a program in MATLAB toolbox or any other toolbox, Scilab toolbox. You'll find this. So this is one of the popular methods which is used for solving nonlinear algebraic equations. So with this, we come to an end of algorithmic part of solving nonlinear algebraic equations. We have looked at different methods. We have looked at gradient-free or successive substitution methods. We have looked at gradient-based or slope-based methods. So in that was Weckstein method, Newton's method, damped Newton method, okay, and so on. Then Broyden update for Newton's method. We moved on to optimization-based methods. Optimization-based method, we looked at the gradient method again. Okay. Then we looked at Newton's method, quasi-Newton method. I have just quickly looked at these things. And Liverberg-Marquardt, which tries to merge the two, gradient and Newton's method. So to solve nonlinear algebraic equations, you know, it's a complex problem. And more we become advanced in computing, we want to solve larger and larger problems. So it's a ever challenging problem, how to solve nonlinear algebraic equations, and there are many, many methods. Okay, so a question that would naturally arise is that which is the method? There is no the method. If there was the method, we wouldn't be required, right? We would be out of business. So you need an expert, you need a person who understands the physics of the problem. You should know how to concoct a solution, how to concoct a recipe. Okay, just like you cook and you have to know the recipe, or you have to form a recipe. So here also, you have to form a solution for a particular problem. And sometimes Newton's method will work, sometimes optimization method will work, sometimes Weckstein method will work. So you have to develop an expertise beyond a point as to how to go about solving these problems. Okay, so it does require this human element. Otherwise, MATLAB would do everything. You just give a problem to MATLAB, and, but it doesn't happen that way. That's good. That's why we get jobs. Okay, so we'll now continue with, I'll say a few things about the convergence of these nonlinear algebraic equations. We cannot give justice to that in this course. It's a very, very advanced topic. But at least you should be sensitized as to what is involved when you talk about convergence. Okay, it's fairly more complex than talking about convergence of iterative schemes for linear algebraic equations, because here you have nonlinearity and things don't work out as nicely as linear algebraic equations. But we'll have a peek at that and then move on to ODE initial value problems. Okay.